So, Nebo, Nebo, Nebo's a word that has played, I've done quite a bit of work around Nebo, right? So, it's Greek word, or Hebrew word, sorry, H5015. Nebo means prophet, but Nebo's a Babylonian deity who presided over learning and letters. Corresponds to Greek Hermes, Latin Mercury, and an Egyptian Thoth, right? Latin Mercury. And we come down into the Chowdhury lexicon and we get Nebo is the planet Mercury, worshipped as the celestial scribe by the Chaldeans. So is this planet what they say on the earth today? Or is this a lodging place of the sun that we see in the Hebrew word for planets? Is this a member, is this a god within the circle of palaces? And Mercury's planet is actually Nebo, because Nebo is also, it's also a mountain, right? Now, Hebrew word H2022 for mountain, we come down into the Chowdhury lexicon and we're getting Father, so further as to the religion of the ancients, especially of the Hebrews, who regarded mountains as holy and as the abodes of deities. So for me, the deities are the gods. And that's what we're getting here in the word planets, that they're the abode of the gods, the lodging places of the sun. These were imagined to be the lodging places of the sun during the 12 months. And they rendered them to superstitious worship. And that's what they're worshipping. They're worshipping the planets, these lodging places of the sun, these abodes of the deities, of the gods. And that's what we're getting for Hebrew word H2022. The ancient Hebrews, they regarded mountains as holy and as the abodes of deities, the gods. And that's what we're getting here for this word planets, the abodes of the gods, and they rendered them for superstitious worship as they worship the planets, as I'm being led to think, they're worshipping the mountains. So we've got Nebo. For me, Nebo is both a god, a celestial body, but Nebo, as I say, well, Nebo's also, it's also a mountain. So, now, I've been wanting to put this down for a while now. So, Joe Embriano at the Fullerton Informer, what do we think of Joe? He's an interesting character, right? He's a very interesting character indeed. I'm not really going to go into now what my thoughts are. This is a positive for, because I watch Joe sometimes. You can see his videos. I pretty much watch all of them because I'm finding it harder and harder now to watch anybody on YouTube. I'm just finding now that the lies are so thick and it's getting harder and harder to find any pages. And this bloke doesn't talk about the scriptures much, but he talks about the evils of the world a lot. And for me, that's good because I just, when I watch, want to sit down and watch YouTube now, I've pretty much given up. I've given up all hope. Oh, not all hope, but I've pretty much given up on trying to find people who just love the scriptures and who just want the truth in the scriptures and to share what they've learned in the scriptures. For me, I either see people that are just outwardly lying or people that just get on there and say that they're teaching. And to me, nobody can teach these scriptures. To me, to be a teacher, yeah, higher entity. Only the higher entities can teach scripture, and we're all just pupils. Never's a long time, but I can't ever see the day where I'll consider myself a teacher of these scriptures. No way. I'm just a pupil. I'm just a guy who's putting down what I learn, right? So I'm not, Joe doesn't say these things, but that's what I see. That's what I see on the earth right now, is that people either say that they're a teacher or they're lying, or pretty much most of the time it's both, right? But I just, when I watch YouTube now, I pretty much just want to learn about what's going on in the world. And as I sit down at night, have some dinner, and I'll put YouTube on for half an hour to an hour, and I just, pretty much now, most of the time, I'm not even turning the TV on. I'm pretty close to getting rid of it, actually. I don't want it sitting there. I don't want TV in this house anymore. I don't watch the TV, but I turn the TV on to watch YouTube, right? Pretty much done with it, though. I think I want it out of here. But in any case, he talks, he seems to have very, very good knowledge about the evils of the world. And most of the things I say, I absolutely believe him. I absolutely believe what he says. It stands up. But in any case, I watch him. I watch Joe Embriano, right? So his last video on his main page was, it's a month ago. He did a series on weather warfare. He did a couple of videos on weather warfare. And it's the last one he did here while he's in his convertible, right? But he talked about Nebo. Check this out.
So back to what I was saying yesterday, folks, I'm going to hit this point again. The way the weather operates in the continental United States is it's pretty simple. In the winter months, because of the air currents in this closed system near the North Pole, Mount Nebo, the magnetic north, you know, the big area up north, right, where the sun never sets in the summer. And, you know, Polaris is hanging out directly on top of it. Folks, in the Gulf of Alaska, we get these storms, okay?
Right. So why does he think that? Why is he saying that? Mount Nebo, the magnetic north, Polaris is hanging out right on top of it. So that's what I've been talking about, right? So it stopped me. That comment just absolutely stopped me because it goes against what the world says, and it's what I've been sitting here putting down, right? Now, I just want to make this clear before I go on that he posted that on the 2nd of February. Now, my videos, you can see I started my first video where I started talking about the Heavenly Mountains here on the 19th of January, right? So that's about 2 weeks before that video. So I just want to make that clear that I'm not doing this because of that comment. Not at all. This comment came a good 2 weeks after I started talking about this, and I've been sitting on this for the best part of a month, just looking for an opportunity to put it down. And this is the thing, I just got so much coming in all the time. I just got things I want to share left, right, and center. And this is an example where it's taken me, what, a good 4 weeks just to get to this, you know? I've just got so much right now I want to say, so much I want to put down. But that's what, for me, is what he's saying. So he's saying that we've got Mount Nebo is the magnetic north. Now, I've had a look at magnetic north on planet Babylon, and all you do is you just get global earth nonsense. So it's very hard to find any sort of discernment with it on planet Babylon. So I'm going to steer clear of that. It's so hard. It's so hard to try to discern this when you look at planet Babylon, because it's all just this globe nonsense, right? But he's got that from somewhere. He's thinking that from somewhere. So what for me he's saying is that we've got the magnetic north is Mount Nebo, so the mountain of so that's the planet of the celestial body, which is Polaris, which is hanging right on top of it. So it's at the peak. Is that the midst of heaven? Is that where it is? I've never seen Polaris. We can't see it from here. We see here Polaris is actually called the North Star, and I've had a look into it. It doesn't appear here at all. And it's a fascinating star. You see this time-lapse photo of it here. So this site's called Earth Sky. And you see everything seems to revolve around this one star in the northern part of the sky. So we all know by now geocentrism, right? Geocentrism, that the Earth doesn't move, but everything else revolves around the Earth. So the Earth is the center of what they call the universe, and everything revolves around the Earth. That's right. Everything revolves around us. And it's just so interesting because that's a big thing that they say. The Earth, that the whole world doesn't revolve around you, right? Now, I'm not saying the whole world revolves around me and it revolves around you. Not at all. But for me, the whole world revolves around the Earth. And we know in Genesis 1 that the earth was made for the man. So for me, it's just leaving me at fever pitch that the entire creation revolves around mankind. Mankind is just the center of the creation. And you look at this globe earth lie, and they just want you to believe that you're just an insignificant speck of dust in an ever-expanding infinite space. And there's a cartoon that I fell for when I was still asleep where it just establishes just how small and how insignificant the Earth is in the whole general scheme of things with the universe, with the entire outside of our solar system. And you just think, it remains, despite everything that's going on the Earth today, it remains the biggest and the grandest lie of them all. And for me, more than ever, it is a point of discernment. If they're pushing the globe, for me, they're out. The Holy Spirit made that very clear to me very, very early on in the piece. They push the globe, they say planet. I know I just said it, but I'm not pushing it. But they say the Earth's a planet. They say it's round. They say solar system and things like that. For me, I'm out of there. And you look at all of these creatures running the world, they want us to believe right now that they're all divided. I don't even want to say the names of the countries, because that might be decried as misinformation at this point if I say a country's name. Everything that goes against the government seems to be misinformation, even if you don't say it. I've had a few days to get used to this. It's just misinformation, right? Misinformation. But you look at it and they're all pushing the boogie. They're all pushing the boogie, and they're all pushing the globe earth lie and the space lie. They're all in lockstep, right? They're all in lockstep. And it's just so interesting. You can still go on YouTube and see whether Bigfoot's true, and it's all there. So, and also Elvis, you go to YouTube and you can see videos done that Elvis is still alive. So that must be true, right? Because YouTube won't stand for misinformation. So if you go onto YouTube, everything there has to be fact, right? Every single last thing on YouTube is fact if they're pulling things down for misinformation. So that means Bigfoot's true and Elvis is true, right? This is where it's gone. This is how stupid. This is how stupid this place is getting. It's just like that for me, they're just fully exposed. And I'm just seeing it more and more and more as the days go on. I'm just getting separated. Just getting separated from this cesspit more and more. Just keep backing your testimony, brothers and sisters. That's the biggest thing I can say to everybody right now. That's what my park video was about that I'm not going to put up, where that segment was on. That's what that video was about. Just backing your testimony. Just keep backing your testimony. You keep backing your testimony while walking in the gospel and the Holy Spirit, He will allow you to do it. I've just got all of these testimonies now that are starting to stack up that I want to share. But in time, I'm just going to see how a few things land right now. I said in the video down at the park, I had a team leader at Telstra. He said to me once, it's one of the best pieces of advice I ever got. He said, Brett, once you share the information, you lose control of the information, mate. And I've always loved that. I've always loved that, and it's always stuck with me. So there's just a few things going on. I've got so many testimonies. I got testimonies coming out of my ears, right, that I have not shared with a soul yet. And they're just, they're getting more and more powerful, these testimonies, by the day. But you keep backing your testimony, your glorious, precious testimony, the way the Holy Spirit has manifested His glorious self to you over your journey with Him while walking in the gospel. And you're going to see unbelievable things happen in your life. That's what's happening to me right now. I marvel every day with what's going on. I'm making these decisions, which people, if they knew me, if I had any friends, they would say that you've lost the plot, Brett. You need to get a grip. You need to deal with those things. I'm like, I'm dealing with it. I'm dealing with everything. I'm just putting all my eggs in the one basket. Total faith in the Holy Spirit, right? Back in my testimony. While walking in the gospel of peace, love and truth, and it just the miracles flow. It's just amazing. It is absolutely amazing. But we'll come back to Polaris. So sorry, so much I want to talk about, so much I want to share. I've just got to try and stay on track. I see the globe Earth as the grandest of them all, because if you can sell the lie about where we actually live, that for me is the biggest of them all. Because they're lying. So that means you tell the biggest lie, then you can sell any of them, and that's what they're doing. And it's gonna get more and more pivotal. The globe Earth lie. It's gonna get more and more pivotal, and more important as we go on in these most profound days that we're in right now. They can be sweet talkers. They can seem so very good, but you see it. You just see it, and it's like they profess to be Bible teachers, and then they say we're on a planet and all that. It's like, we haven't read the book, mate. You can't have read the book. You cannot read this book with an honest heart, just wanting the truth, doing it with the Holy Spirit, and finish that book and possibly think that we live on an earth that moves. You can't. It's not possible. If you're professing to be teaching the scriptures and you're pushing that nonsense, you're lying. You have to be. For me, you simply must. You simply must. So it's hard to find discernment about this magnetic north, but I look at this photo, and to me, it says a lot. So everything in the north revolves around this one star. Everything. So I know they talk about the as above, the so below, whether it's something to do with that, where this is potentially the earth and everything's revolving around the earth, and we're looking at some sort of mirror here of the heavens, because Moses was commanded to make to make the pattern of those very heavenly things. So is that, that this could very well be a mirror of the true cosmology of the earth. The earth is right there in the center that they will have us believe is the sun. That's the earth, and everything else is revolving around the earth and mankind. Potentially, right? Potentially. So the Polaris is the North Star. So I'm looking at this again just because Joe Embriano said,
in this closed system near the North Pole, Mount Nebo, the magnetic north, you know, the big area up north, right, where the sun never sets in the summer. And, you know, Polaris is hanging out directly on top of it.
So I now test that. Mount Nebo is the magnetic north, and Polaris is hanging out right on top of that, right? So it's an incredible photo, because you look at this, and potentially this could be, the outer rings could be like the lower, we could be inside the mountain. And this is the base of the mountain, and that's the very top. That's the very top of the mountain. So we're looking at a celestial body and its planet. That's what I'm being led to think. So it's such a fascinating comment, right? And he just said it, and it just out of nowhere, just out of nowhere, as I'm talking about this, my head just went, I couldn't believe it, man. I couldn't believe it. Check out this blurb. The North Star, or Pole Star, aka Polaris, is famous for holding nearly still in our sky while the entire northern sky moves around it, right? So this is what I say. I'm seeing this potentially as a mirror of the Earth. So everything revolves in the north around Polaris. And I'm seeing now there's a distinct difference going on here. There's something about the northern, what they call the northern and the southern hemisphere on the Earth. It's a term I want to get away from, because sphere, it's pertaining to the ball. But the south of the equator, and I'm being led to think the equator is a real thing, as are the tropics. You're looking at the south of the equator and north of the equator, they're behaving completely differently. Completely differently. I look at that flat Earth, that geo, what is it they call it? The Gleason's map, to me, it does not work. It does not work, and I've been saying this for a few years now to anybody that cares to listen. That map just simply doesn't work, because you look at that map and the sun never goes below the Tropic of Capricorn. Now, here on the New South Wales Central Coast, I'm south of the Tropic of Capricorn, and right through summer, I see the sun rise south of the east-west line, and it sets all the way down there, right down the southwest. It's almost further south than what it is west midsummer. It's way south, right? Way south. And that sun, that sun on the Gleason's map, it never, ever, ever goes below south of the Tropic of Capricorn, and the Tropic of Capricorn is like over 1,000 k's from here. And the further south you go during the middle of summer here in Australia, the further south you go, the further the sun goes south. And the further south you go, so you go down to Melbourne in the middle of summer, and it's exceedingly hot. It's scorchingly hot down there. But then you get to about Tasmania, and it starts to cool off again. But the sun goes further and further and further south in the middle of summer, the further south you go. So the further south you go, you would think you're getting closer to that object that's south of you. So it's south of me here. So the further in that direction you go toward that object, the further away from you that object gets, the sun. So there's something going on here. I look at it, I've done a video on this a few years ago now, where in the middle of summer, the sun comes up, it tracks up, I'll put it up on a map, it tracks up from Auckland, it rises around about Auckland, and then it sets sort of Perth and south of Perth. So where's it coming from? So it's coming from all the way down here, and it's heading to a direction south of Africa. That's the path of the sun here on the New South Wales Central Coast in the middle of summer. So where's it coming from? Where's it going to? There's something we mark. You look at the Northern Hemisphere and everything just makes sense. Everything just makes sense. But nothing does here. Nothing. I to this day, I can't find rest on it. And it's something I dearly want to know more about. Nothing makes sense about the cosmology on the Earth here. And I'm here. I'm in Australia. And I'm saying these things are true. This is my witness. This is what's going on, right? So there's something completely different going on between the north and the south. And to my knowledge, there's no southern star. I'll have a look as I process this part of this video, but I'm not seeing any star that matches the north star in the south. There's something... I see this, and this to me could very well be the mid part of the heavens. So this could be where the sun stood still in the midst of Gibeon, for example, where the angels are flying in the midst of heaven. I'm being led to think this could be the case, because this is the magnetic north, is it not? Polaris, the North Star. Don't worry about what Joe and Briano said, but for me, what he said, it's stacking up. It seems true to me. But I see this as we're looking inside a mountain. We're looking from inside a mountain and we're looking up into the peak, and that potentially there is the midst of heaven all the way up there. So what about us down here? Where are we? It's very strange. It's very, 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 very strange indeed. Now, on my last video, Gibeon Celestial Bodies in the Midst of Heaven, Sister Jamie, you left this comment. Sister Jamie, how you doing? I want to just take this opportunity again just to thank you for all your support and just to let you know you are much loved here and you've come to mean so very, very much to me. And just to have you there, someday, sister, I don't think you even begin to understand. Some days, just the impact you have. And you've just got this. We've just been talking about the televisions, right? So there's a photo of mine. I put it into my bedroom and it's facing the wall, and I think I'm pretty well done. I look over here now at my entertainment unit where it once was, and I think of all of those drunken Saturday afternoons with that TV on that entertainment unit, drinking myself stupid, and all the parties I've hosted with that entertainment unit and with that television. It's just incredible. It's just incredible how the story goes that we've had this rain here that I'm going to get to in just a sec, and I get leaks here, and it's complicated. It's complicated, the leaks and what I actually do about it. It gets a very, very, it's a complicated game that I'm playing right now about them. But I came out the other morning and there's leaks and it's leaking down pretty well. It was just missing my television, but all my electrics there, I've got this leak. So what did I do? I went and unplugged the TV, and I've been talking about and I've been thinking about getting rid of the TV, and I unplugged it because I don't want it to be destroyed through the leaks. And Jamie, you mentioned in a comment there this morning that it reminds you of the Jews of heaven, right? It's just like, some days I think, as I say, I think my head's just going to blow off, man. I think it's just going to completely blow off. So, Sister Jamie, thank you. It's all I can say, really. It's all I can say. I just thank you. Thank you for everything, dear sister. It's just, you've just got this uncanny knack. You do it most days, you know. You do it most days where I sit down and whatever good it is for me to have a plan with these videos, I sit down and I plot and I pray and I think about what I'm going to do about these videos, and then you pop up and the course of the day just changed and you've done it again, right? You've done it again. So you said this, Joe is an absolutely interesting character. Funny he mentioned Mount Nebo, where the sun never sets. I was going to ask how you fit that into the 12 hours in a day. Like you say, there's always more to consider. So yeah, it's very interesting now, because if we've got a situation where we've got 24-hour day sunshine, we've also got 24-hour a day darkness. So I'm being led to think we come into this word hours, G5610. The Lord Jesus Christ says, are there not 12 hours in the day? So this for me is, it's both a parable, an allegory, but for me, he's also speaking about physical light for me. He's saying that there's 12 hours every day of sunlight, of daylight every day. But he's also saying that this is the division between light and dark. And God said, let there be light. And there was light, and the Lord Jesus Christ was made manifest due to the works of the devil. So I see it as both. Most certainly I see it as both here. So just for the sake of this, as what we're talking about, the cosmology and the earth, I'm just going to hone in on the physical, fleshly, earthly aspect of this scripture now, right? So the Lord Jesus Christ says, are there not 12 hours in the day? So that makes it fact. The Lord Jesus Christ says there's 12 hours in the day. Now, Jamie, you also, just going on memory, you mused the question as to whether he could be talking about, I've got the comment here, I consider that maybe Jesus is speaking of the earth in its entirety, not just speaking of an isolated location. Over the earth, there is 12 hours in the day. Of course, this is conjecture. I don't know, just a thought. Now, that for me is absolutely correct. So why I see the cosmology of the earth today, my witness and what we're presented with, every single minute of every single day, probably not every single minute, that's probably gone too far, but every single day on the earth, looking at the earth in its entirety, we're looking at 12 hours a day and 12 hours of light. But where that 12 hours a day and light is actually spread across, that's where it varies. So in the summer solstice here, in the southern part of the earth, the southern half of the earth, at that summer solstice, all that 24-hour light's down at the, what they call the South Pole, but the north gets none of it. And at the equinoxes, it's meant to be an even spread. And it goes from all the light in the south during the summer solstice here, and it gradually gets darker and darker till you get to the top of the earth, Mount Nebo, right? Mount Nebo Polaris is what Joe's saying here, and it gets to complete darkness. And I'm seeing that's exactly how it works with these hours as well. And I'm also seeing it with the moon. It's so hard to put this down, but I'm seeing all sorts of similarities here. So this is absolutely true what you're saying here, sister, most certainly. But what I'm being led to think the Lord Jesus Christ is talking about here, he's talking about everybody as individuals, as mankind, as a collective. Are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of the world. So for me, the Lord Jesus Christ is saying that if you're walking in the light, if you're walking with him, with the Lord Jesus Christ, well, then you've got 12 hours in your day. But if you're walking in the dark, so you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, well, then you're not walking in the light at all. So for me, he's talking about individuals here and their specific locations. But you come back into, this is also an allegory. This is also an allegory for your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, with your relationship with the truth. But for me, he's talking about individuals as a collective, but most poignantly here, he's talking about every individual and their actual location. So when we come back into the tools, this is where it gets interesting, because you consider the comment that you've made. And you said, funny how he mentioned Mount Nebo where the sun never sets. I was going to ask how you thought that fits into 12 hours in a day. So the Lord Jesus Christ says there's 12 hours of daylight in every day. So in the tools, it's pertaining to this one here, 3 and 4. The daytime, bounded by the rising and setting of the sun, a day. So a day is determined by the moment the sun rises to the moment the sun sets. That's a day. And we've got an hour. So this is the Greek word for hour, sorry, that the Lord Jesus Christ talks about in John 11. And we've got an hour is a 12th part of that. So we come back to your comment, right? So this is good. This is really good. It's a good example. And it's actually given me pause to consider these things a bit more deeply. So I first see this comment and I think to myself, well, okay, if the sun never sets, that means you've got 24 hours of daylight. So we come back into this, and for me, an hour, a 12th part of 24 hours of sunlight for me means when you've got the 24-hour day sun, that means each hour is 2 hours. But while we've got the 24-hour daytime, the 24-hour sunlight, conversely, we've got 24 hours of darkness. So if we've got 24 hours of darkness where the sun never rises or the sun never sets, well, then what I'm saying can't be the case, right? Because it's bounded by the rising and the setting of the sun, a 12th part of that time. So these things can't be, right? But this is the thing. This is the thing. It's just like, for me, it's exactly the same as the moon. So the moon is only full for a brief moment. It's like the clock. The moon and the sun are the clocks in the sky. And the moon is always moving. And then it gets to, what's a prop I can use? It gets to, the moon moves. So it gets to my nose. And that's the point it's full. But the moon's always moving. So it moves, 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 full. But it just keeps moving. It's only full for that one brief now moment. That's when the moon's full. And for me, it's exactly the same with the summer and the winter solstices, right? So here on the New South Wales Central Coast, well, I've got up Sydney. We've got the winter solstice coming up this year on the 21st of June. But you notice it happens at 7:13 p.m. So it's a very definitive time. It's a moment in time. And it's the same with the summer solstice on the 22nd of December. It's going to be at 8:47 p.m. So it's a moment in time as well, right? So we take these two photos here, and at the top, we've got the winter solstice here in Australia. That's this moment in time here. So we look at these two photos and we can see that it's not exact because they're very hard to source. They're very hard to source the exact moment where the winter and summer solstice takes place on photo, because you can see at the top here, during the winter solstice, there's a lot more sun up at the very top of the world than what there is. You see this darkness, it's not quite right, right? But what I'm trying to establish here is that this is the winter solstice and this is the summer solstice here in Australia at this one moment in time. So the winter solstice, that's this moment in time here. The summer solstice, that's this moment in time here at 8:47. So at 8:47 on Thursday the 22nd of December, it's going to look like this. But at the 7:13 p.m. at the 21st of June this year, it's going to look like this. Now, it's only going to be at an instant. It's only going to be at that one moment in time. So the way I see it is from the winter solstice, you've got that one moment, it's pure darkness. But after this moment in time, it's becoming light again. Now, before this moment in time, it's going dark from when it was last 24-hour light. So at this moment, leading up to this moment, it's been darkness going into full light. And from this moment, it goes from full light and it starts going back to being dark, because it's only that moment in, it's only 24-hour perfect sunlight for that one moment in time. So from this point here, it starts to go dark till it reaches this point here the next year, where it's going light, light, light into dark. and then it goes to dark for that one moment in time here, and then it starts to become light again. So during that 24-hour day of darkness on the winter solstice, there's actually some light, even though if you're there, you probably wouldn't see it. You probably wouldn't even see the sun. I don't know. I don't know how these things actually take place. But what I'm establishing here and what I'm articulating here is that on that 24 hours of darkness day, the solstice at the South Pole or the North Pole on the day of the solstice, you're not going to have 24 hours of total, in theory, darkness, even though when you're there, that's how it's most certainly going to play out, because it's only that solstice for a brief moment in time. So exactly how much light you get, it's hard to know, just like it's hard to know how much light you actually get here, because for me, you're not going to get exactly 24 hours. It's going to be slightly less because you're still going dark up to that point. Boom, it's full light. And from that point on, after that, it starts to go dark again. So it's not 24 hours. It might be 23 hours and 59 and a half minutes. It might even be less. But the thing is, even if it's only 1 second, let's say you've only got 1 second, that's what this is calculated on. So if you've only got 1 second of daylight, well, then a 12th part of that 1 second, that makes up an hour at the pole, whatever pole is having the winter solstice at that time. So that's what I'm being led to think. So we come back to the comment, Sister Jamie, and that's the comment. Funny he mentioned Mount Nebo where the sun never sets. I was going to ask how you that might fit into 12 hours a day. Like you say, there's always more to consider. That's what I'm being led to think. That's how I feel this calculates now, where it's never truly a full 24 hours, both darkness and daylight, because it's one moment in time. You got one moment in time for the solstice, so it's going from light to dark, and then from that moment of pure darkness, it starts to become light again, where it culminates here at the summer solstice, where it's going from dark to pure light, and then it starts going from pure light to pure dark till we get back at this point, and on we go, and it just continues to loop just like that. So that's what I'm being led to think. So for me, most certainly, that's what we're looking at for an hour, and I'm strongly being led to think now, thanks to your question, Sister Jamie, for me, I feel now we've absolutely got a confirmation here that that's what the Lord Jesus Christ is talking about, no matter where you are. Because absolutely, every single day on the earth as a collective, we've got 12-hour daylight and we've got 12-hour night every single day. But every single location, that's not the case. And for me, that's what the Lord Jesus Christ is talking about here. Are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, right? If any man walk in the day. But he's talking about a spiritual light and a spiritual darkness here. But that's what a parable means. Part of the meaning of a parable is the Lord Jesus Christ gives an earthly meaning to an earthly example to something that's got a heavenly meaning. So here he's talking about the physical sunlight as he talks about the light and dark of the heavenly kingdom. Now, as I say, I'm seeing it with the moon as well. So we take the next full moon here on the New South Wales Central Coast on Friday the 18th of March. So I liken this to the summer solstice. It's in one moment in time. We see here it occurs at 6:20 and 37 seconds. It's one moment in time. Now, it's interesting to note, that it actually is full here before it rises. So we don't actually see it while it's full, because it hasn't risen yet, right? Now, we come into the last time it was new, and it's not giving me an exact time, but for me it's the same principle as the full moon. So the full moon, we get at 6:20 and 37 seconds. It will be exactly the same for the new moon. It's one moment in time. tick, 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 tick. This moment is no more unique than any other tick of the clock. It just happens to be that moment where the moon goes new. So that occurred on Thursday, the 3rd of March. So I liken this to the winter solstice. It's one moment in time. Now, from this moment in time, it goes from being completely dark to start to become light. And that's what we get at that they call it the first quarter. But for me, this is the half waxing gibbous. So it starts to, you can see it's half illuminated now. So this for me is the spring equinox. The spring equinox where it's divided exactly in half, 12 and 12, and the moon is 50-50. 12 and 12, I mean light and dark. Light 12 hours, as the clock dictates on planet Babylon today. 12 hours of light and 12 hours of dark. And it's been going light from this very moment. But before this very moment, it was going from when the moon was last full, because from this moment, it starts to wane. And then a week later, we've got the waning half gibbous, right? So we'll go back to the start. So for me, we've got the winter solstice. It tick, 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 boom. It hits this point just one moment in time. Now from this moment, it starts to become illuminated again. A week later, so this is the winter solstice, one moment in time, tick, 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 winter solstice, tick, tick, tick. And then a week later, we see it go from that, and we've got half and half, half light and half dark, because it's starting to wax in her light. So this for me is the spring equinox. It's coming out of full darkness and it's coming into light. And it continues to wax, it continues to grow in more and more light up until the full moon, which is the summer solstice, where we get the 24 hours of daylight and we get the 100% fully illuminated moon. And it only happens at one brief moment in time. So it's been waxing from this, it goes to this till it reaches this moment in time. Tick. At that moment in time, it then begins to wane, where we find ourselves a week later, where it's the waning half, which for me is the autumn equinox, and it continues to wane, continues to wane, continues to wane, till we get back to the new moon, where it's waning, waning, waning from light to here, and now it's fully dark. But it starts again. A second before, that one moment in time before, it's got a little bit of light and then it goes completely dark. But then from the next moment, we've got a little bit of light and it starts to become light again. So we go from the winter solstice and then we go the next week, it's the spring equinox to the summer solstice to the autumnal equinox, and then we get back to the winter solstice and it goes fully dark and then it starts to become light again, and then the cycle continues. And for me, that's exactly the same principle as what we're getting for the winter and the summer solstices. So as usual, Jamie, from the bottom of my heart, I thank you for the comment. It's certainly given me pause to consider these things, but most certainly, and I've learned more about the cosmology of the Earth as a result. So thank you, dear sister. And for me, it's giving me a lot more confidence now that that's what an hour is. The Lord Jesus Christ says there's 12 hours in the day, and the word hour, what an hour actually is, it's the moment the sun rises and sets, and it's a 12th part of that is actually an hour in that day. That's what I'm being led to think right now. But in any case, we'll come back now to this article in Earth Sky that's telling us about the celestial body of Polaris. The North Star or Pole Star, aka Polaris, is famous for holding nearly still in our sky while the entire northern sky moves around it. That could go to as above, so below for me, because the entire creation moves around the Earth and everything moves around mankind because the Earth was made for the man. And that's the global change law, right? That's because they Earth worship. They worship the creature rather than the creator. That's because it's located nearly at the North Celestial Pole. So I'm not too sure about that. I don't know why it's nearly, but it's not. It's hard to know the truth, right? At the North Celestial Pole, the point around where the entire northern sky turns. So it's just so fascinating, isn't it? Like, this is planet Babylon, and they're telling us that the entire northern sky turns because it does. Everything in the heavens moves because the Earth's not moving. It's critical to all this. Polaris marks the way due north. As you face Polaris and stretch your arms sideways, your right hand points due east and your left hand points due west. Amazing. I'd love to see this star. About face from Polaris steers you due south. So it's not the brightest star in the nighttime sky, as it's commonly believed. It's only about the 50th brightness. But you can find it easily. And once you do, you see it shining in the northern sky every night from the northern hemisphere location. So anybody up north, can you see it? Can you see this star? Is there anything distinctive about this star that you feel could be relevant here? Now, we get a picture here. So we get, it's part of, it seems to be part, well, they say it's part of the Big Dipper. Now, from what I can see, the Big Dipper, it's actually a part of this constellation Ursa Major. So we come back to Hebrew word H4208 for planets, and we've got King Josiah. He's pulling down all the host worship, the sun, the moon, and the planets. There it is there, and to all the host of heaven. So King Josiah is pulling all this down. We only get it the once in the scriptures, and of course it's as planet. Constellations, signs of the zodiac, maybe strongly being led to think that that's an absolutely. These constellations are, in fact, the signs of the zodiac. We get apparently from H5140 in the sense of reigning, being led to think this pertains to the dews of heaven, the blessing of the Lord, a constellation, and they go on to worship these planets. I'm being led to think it could be another manifestation of loving the creature rather than the creator, loving the blessing rather than he who gives the blessing, the glorious Holy Spirit. Apparently from H5140, in the sense of reigning, the dews of heaven are constellation. So I'm being led to think that these constellations, these planets, is actually where the Lord, this is where the dews of heaven emanate from. It's just amazing. I'm looking out here right now, and there is a great big chemtrail in the sky, and we have just had the most amazing rain spell. And I went up to the park, actually. I'll put it up now. I wasn't planning on doing it like this, but we've just got this chemtrail. And don't forget what we've learned, right? We mustn't forget what we've learned. And I have been seeing here over the last, particularly around 6 months, that we've been getting absolutely smashed with chemtrails. And we've just come into this most significant rain event. In fact, I might just go out and get a couple of shots of this and come back. So you can see it's not a huge chemtrail. It's not the biggest chemtrail that we've ever seen, but there it is, right? And that's all we need to see. But for me, it's just everything's the will of the Holy Spirit. And for me, I feel potentially the Holy Spirit wanted me to see that then. Don't forget what we've learned, right? It's just been absolutely relentless here. It's just been torrential rain for well over a week here now, maybe even longer. It has just been a sustained assault from the heavens. It just will not let up. Is this the Holy Spirit pouring out his wrath, or is this the Holy Spirit using these creatures to pour out his wrath? Because don't forget what we've learned, right? So all of these truths that we've been coming into during our journey, for me, it's starting to come to a head now with everything that's happening upon the earth right now. We're in some most profound times indeed. And this has just given me pause just to remember this one thing as well. The chemtrails. Why do they do it? Why do they do it? Because with their global change lie, they've now got a license to do, if they can control the weather, which people are giving these people credit to go to the moon 50 years ago. They give them credit to put little rovers on Mars. And they give them all of this credit to be able to do all of these things that we know are a lie. And there's documented, they're openly saying now that they have to block out the sun to defeat the impacts of global change and geoengineering. It's a well-known fact now. They're well out now saying that it's a fact. And for me, if we are still thinking they can't control the weather or have an impact on the weather themselves, for me, it's very, very naive indeed, because they're in fact saying it. It's always the people's fault, right? So they dictate that the people live a certain way, have to go out every day and slave for money. And when people go out every day and slave for money, well, then that's not good enough, because they're ruining their planet, right? They're ruining the planet. It's always the people, right? We all know the story by now, as the wealthy, they get around on their private jets, and don't even start me on car racing. And they've now got a license. They can now just do whatever they want with the weather, right? So don't forget what we've learned. And to see a big chemtrail now there, it feels like an enormous confirmation that that's what's going on here. I've just spent the morning with Mum, and I just got through telling Mum this, that I've been seeing those chemtrails for 6 months, and you just sit here and you don't tell anyone because no one wants to hear. Everyone just thinks you're mad. Everyone believes this thing that there's no evidence and you can't see it, but you actually point to this thing in the sky, and there's been some bloke in a white coat on the TV at some point who's just explained it away, right? Just explain it away. So they won't believe what you can see, and they do believe what you can't, and it's just whatever the TV tells them, right? It's whatever the TV tells them. So it's not a huge chemtrail, but there it is. It's a chemtrail, right? And in fact, I want to have a look at this. So you play this video that I've got, and this is just after it's all started to clear, right? So I look at this, and for me, this trail is absolutely... it's coming out of this cloud, and it seems to be joining to that cloud. I don't really get to, you don't get to see it that well behind the tree there. But for me, this chemtrail is coming out of this cloud, and it's potentially going into this one down here. So it reminds me of this term cloud seeding. It's a type of weather modification that aims to change the amount or type of precipitation that falls from clouds by dispersing substances into the air that serve as cloud condensation or ice nuclei after the microphysical processes within the cloud. And just this term cloud seeding, right? So they're absolutely admitting that they do it. And this article down here just makes me laugh when we come into the pictures. The pilots who make it rain, right? As though they're doing us some sort of enormous service here by chemtrailing the skies, and then they make it rain. Like, those who are causing all this madness are actually, and that's what they do, don't they? They create the problem and then they bring about the solution. So cloud seeding for me, it's all about chemtrails. And you look at this one here, this photo here, and it's coming out of the cloud, right? And that's what I'm seeing here. I'm most certain, because all the clouds, they've started to peel back here, they've started to clear. And for me, I'm seeing potentially we've absolutely got a chemtrail that's joining two clouds here as these storm clouds peel back. So as I say, it's not a big chemtrail, but there it is, and potentially it's a quite significant one indeed. So this is the devastation. I went down to the park there yesterday, So this is where I do my park videos, right? So where I do my park videos, the bench I sit on is just down there, and that's sort of where I walk around there, right? So all of this water, you see all that down there, that's the edge of the lake. So all of this here, the lake's actually burst its banks, and it's coming up here. So this isn't just flood water sitting on the ground. This is actually the lake coming up. I can't remember the last time I saw this. I don't know if I've ever seen it in all my years here living on the New South Wales Central Coast. But I'll play this through now. So you can just see the depths of the devastation here. And we got more rain this morning. I took this yesterday. It's Sunday now. It's the 6th of March today. And we actually got some more rain there this morning, and it was very heavy rain. And you can see just the absolute devastation here. And I went for a walk, so that's where I walk. That's the edge of the lake there. And you can see all the waters have encroached up here. And that's sort of where I do my park videos, down on those benches down there. And you can see this is all the lake water that's encroaching up. It's just amazing. Like just the absolute devastation here. You see that chair? How deep this water is. It's just absolutely, it's devastating. Like, I've never seen rain like it, and I would think there's people losing a lot of their property here as a result of this. And to look up there right now and see a chemtrail, you just think we are living in the most profound times, and the Lord Jesus Christ tells us that there'll be nothing hidden that won't be made manifest, and I see it right now. It's just all coming out in the open. And another thing I'm seeing, I was going to talk about this when it's actually the plan to go down to the park and talk about the strike that I got for misinformation. But another thing I'm seeing right now as well is just this awakening. I'm seeing this awakening, and to me it's all planned. It's all planned. People are, they're becoming aware of the evil, but they're very, very late for dinner, right? They're starting to become aware of the, and I'm not saying that in a high and mighty way or nothing like that. I'm saying it's because they've been rejecting truth's messengers for all this time, but now that it's directly affecting them, they're seeing it. They're seeing it, and they're getting angry about it. And for me, it's all by design. It's exactly what these monsters want. They want them to get angry. They want everybody to know that all roads leads to the World Economic Thought Forum. They want people to know, and they want people to be angry so that they will accept the solution. And what's the solution? Well, the solution, he's going to be great, right? He's going to be great, and he's going to fool them all to build an image to the beast, right? To himself with his false prophet. That's where I reckon we are. That's where I'm being led to think we are, where we are. And I'm sensing too that other members of the body of Christ, they think this as well. So to see that chemtrail out there now in the face of all this devastation, what else is a guy supposed to think, right? What else is a guy supposed to think? Are you going to give me a strike again for misinformation, YouTube? Because I look up there and see a chemtrail, and I also see flooding. So those two things can't be connected, right? That must be misinformation. It must be. Misinformation, right? Misinformation. Let's just check out the term.
Well, that's nice of them. What was that for? To seize the vaccines. Well, can I say to them that the vaccines are working and they're preventing a lot of Queenslanders from ending up in our hospitals? So I think they should stop spreading misinformation, and I think perhaps they should go and speak to a medical professional to talk to them about how good it is to have the vaccine.
Let me say this to every single member. You open up this state and you let the virus in here, and every child under 12 is vulnerable. Every single child, if anyone has any children under 12 to 0, is vulnerable because they are the unvaccinated, Mr. Smith.
If we all take this very seriously.
And you weren't aware of that until now?
No, I wasn't, no. Thank you for telling me.
It hurts my nose when they do it, and I feel like they go too far in my nose.
It hasn't been a raging success, but I think part of that is me learning how to do it properly.
Who sees the vaccines? Well, can I say to them that the vaccines are working and they're preventing a lot of Queenslanders from ending up in our hospitals? So I think they should stop spreading misinformation.
It's just blowing me away, this. It's absolutely blowing me away. It's just getting so ridiculous. But in any case, coming back to this word planet, so yeah, being led to think that this is pertaining to the dews of heaven in the sense of reigning. So it's telling me that these 12 planets potentially is what the Holy Spirit uses to give his people the blessing. And they went on to worship the blessing rather than the blesser. But we get a constellation, a zodiacal sign, perhaps as affecting the weather, right? Not physical weather, I'm being led to think it could, but I'm being led to think God's relationship with mankind. He does it through these planets. So if these planets are wicked and evil, well, we've got a problem, right? We've got a problem. But if these planets are in lockstep with the Lord, for me, we're looking at a Garden of Eden type dew of heaven happening here, right? And we're certainly not there at the moment on planet Babylon, right? Being strongly led to think there's a big problem with these 12 planets today on planet Babylon, being led to think maybe the congregation of the mighty. But we get compare H4216. Now, when we put the Hebrew word in the planet Babylon, we get mainly Hebrew results, but we get this one here over on the right. The zodiac is a belt-shaped region of the sky that extends approximately 8 degrees north or south of the ecliptic, the apparent path of the sun across the celestial sphere over the course of the year. The paths of the moon and visible planets are within the belt of the zodiac. So the path of the sun goes through these zodiacs, right? These 12 lodging places of the sun. And this is also the circle of palaces. And it's also the abode of the gods, right? So we look at the images, and that's what we're getting. For me, we're getting these 12 star signs that they all seem to be worshipping today. I'm being led to think that these are the 12 planets, and these are the 12, these are that affect the weather, that affect the dews of heaven. So I am seeing potentially a big drama here with these planets as it relates to the dews of heaven. But we come back into Maseroth, right? So I'm being led to think that Maseroth, H4216, this is the word that we're getting for planets. Compare H4216. The planets are the abode of the gods, and it's also the 12 lodging places of the sun, the 12 signs of the zodiac, these being the circle of palaces. So we get Maseroth, H4216, which of course we're getting from the word planets. It's the 12 signs of the zodiac and their 36 associated constellations. Now, I read a couple of days ago, it may have been in Joshua, where the Levites, the priests, they actually got 48 cities given to them. They didn't get an inheritance, but the other 11 tribes had to give them cities out of their inheritance, and they got 48. So that's the only time I see the number 48 on its own in the scriptures. We get it with other numbers, like it might be 148 or the like, but the number 48, that's the only time I can see it in the scriptures. And it pertains to the priest. And for me, the priest, I'm seeing that they're more and more the Levites are celestial bodies. They're the messengers of the Lord of the celestial bodies. Same Hebrew word as angels, and we get in that word angels in the Old Testament, H4397, we get priests and prophets and teachers just going on memory. And I don't know whether this is connected or what, but as I say, we've got these two scriptures in Numbers 35:7 and Joshua 21:41. This is the only time that I see 48 on its own in the scriptures. I see these two times. And it's pertaining to the one thing where the Levites are given 48 cities out of the other tribes' inheritance. All the cities which ye shall give to the Levites shall be 48 cities. them shall you give with their suburbs. It becomes an interesting word indeed as well. And all the cities of the Levites within the possession of the children of Israel were 48 cities with their suburbs, right? 48. And that's what we're getting here for Maseroth. We're getting the 12 signs of the zodiac and their 36 associated constellations. So whether we've actually got a connection going on here, I'm not sure. But this word cities, I put this down previously, this word cities, it's Hebrew word H5892, and we get it 1,074 of the 1,089 times we get it as city. Then we also get it as town, everyone, and we get six variants. But it means excitement and anguish, right? Of terror, a city, town, a place of waking and guarded, and then we get a city, town, right? So the main outline of biblical usage we get for this word city is excitement and anguish. And this is what the Levites get. They get 48 cities out of the inheritance of the children of Israel. And we've got Maseroth is the 12 signs of the zodiac and their 36 associated constellations. So when I started this read of the scriptures, I was looking out for this number 48. And I saw it the other day, and as I say, I can't see it anywhere else in the scriptures. So is it connected? Do we have a connection here? Potentially. Because as I say, I've done this before, this trial, but when we have a look at this Hebrew word H5892, we can see that it's from H5782. And we get it at the top. From H5782, a city, a place, guarded by waking or a watch, right? Now, what I can see in the scriptures is that the city is the inhabitants. So when the city becomes a widow, it's stripped of its inhabitants. So I see a connection with the city and the feminine, potentially. But a city is a place that's guarded by waking or watching, as it gives us this Hebrew word H5782. Now that's what this is. It's to stir and lift up, awake, raise, arise, master, raised out, and we get a variant. To rouse oneself, awaken, awake in sight, to rouse oneself, awake, right? To be roused, to be awoken, to be roused, right? So to be stirred, to be woken up. H5782, and that's the word that we get from the word cities, right? Hebrew word H5892. Now, we look at the Hebrew letter and the Hebrew number, and we get H5894, H5892, right? The Hebrew letter, and then we get that one. It's exactly the same, right? They're exactly the same. So this one means it's the city. And if we get it from H5782, which is pertaining to rousing oneself to be awaken, right? And it's in the sense of waking or watching. Excitement, anguish of terror. And we get H5892 and this Hebrew letter, H5894 and this Hebrew letter. And this word is the waking, wakeful one, a watcher and an angel, right? Corresponding to H5782, a watcher, i.e. an angel, as guardian, a watcher. H5782, and that's the Hebrew word, H5782, that pertains to being awoken, that we're getting for this word city, H5782. And the Hebrew words are exactly the same. And these are the wakeful watchers, a watcher, i.e. an angel, those who are guarding the souls of men, right? The cities. So as I say, I don't know. I don't know whether this is actually connected or not, but that's most certainly the trial. This Hebrew letter for the watchers, the higher entities guarding the souls of men, is exactly the same Hebrew letter as what we're getting for city, and city offices H5782, and H5782, it pertains to being awoken, aroused, the wakeful watchers, right? So how it pertains to a city, I'm not sure, but what I'm seeing potentially is that we're getting the watchers, the wakeful ones, those who are guarding the souls of men, they're actually guarding over the city over the people, right? So when we look at these two scriptures, and I see the Levites have got 48 cities, and I'm also seeing that the Levites are the H4397 messengers of the Lord of the celestial bodies, and that word, the H6635 celestial bodies, and that word H4397 for angels, it gives us priests, prophets, and teachers. It leads me to think that we may have another manifestation here. I don't know. I don't know whether this is connected or what. But the Levites got 40 in 8 cities, and all of these connections that I'm getting with the Levites being celestial bodies, they get 40 in 8. And this word Maseroth that I'm looking at, we're looking at the 12 signs of the zodiac and their 36 associated constellations. So that's 48, right? Potentially, we're looking at 48 constellations. They get 48 cities. And for me, the cities, it's just got the celestial watches written all over it. But they're the 12 signs of the zodiac, right? Maseroth are the 12 signs of the zodiac. I'm being led to think that Maseroth is this combined. These 12 lodging places of the sun, these 12 signs of the zodiac, the actual circle of palaces, the 12 lodging places of the sun, for me combined, is this. This is Maseroth, right? Now, when we put the Hebrew letter into planet Babylon, well, we just get hundreds and thousands and sprinkles, right? So it's quite mystifying. This is the Hebrew word for Maseroth, and it's pretty well wall to wall. I'm not seeing where it changes. It's just confectionery. For me, it's got nothing to do with the celestial at all, and this seems to me to be a lifetime away. Well, that one looks like my park when it's not flooded. A lifetime away from the circle of palaces, right? So that's the actual Hebrew letter that we get for Maseroth. But when we actually put the word Maseroth into planet Babylon, well, it's a very different proposition indeed. Maseroth is a biblical Hebrew word found in the book of Job, and literally meaning constellations, right? Literally meaning constellations. While others interpret the word as garland of crowns. That's interesting. Now, the word garland, it doesn't actually appear in the scriptures, but we're getting results from these other so-called versions of the scriptures. So the word garland, it's a decoration. A garland is a decorative braid, knot, or wreath of flowers, leaves, or other material. Garlands can be worn on the head or around the neck, hung on an inanimate object, or laid in a place of cultural or religious importance. And the images, it's some sort of, oh, that's interesting, it's Christmas, right? Okay. All right, it's Christmas. It's Christmas decorations. A garland, right? A garland. Now, we get these three in the DBY, and we get 2 Kings 7:30 behind every garland. So this is talking about Solomon's house. Now, in Proverbs 1, we read of Solomon reminding his son to hear the instruction of his father and not to forsake the law of thy mother. So we're reading about the instruction of his father and the law of the mother. Now, Proverbs 4, we're reading about wisdom. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and get understanding. So, Proverbs 1, we're speaking about the instruction of the father and the law of the mother. For they shall be a garland of grace unto thy head and chains about thy neck. So Proverbs 4, we're talking about wisdom. So it's a wreath, right? It's a wreath of grace unto thy head and chains about thy neck, the ornaments. And Proverbs 4, we're talking about wisdom. She shall give to thy head a garland of grace, a crown of glory will she bestow upon thee. So, right, a garland. So we get this one in the NKJV. And it's Revelation 12:1, right? Now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland, right? But we all know that this is actually a crown. So in the other version, we go from the garland, the wreath, and now we go to a crown of 12 stars. Greek word, G4735. Now, we get this word the 18 times, and each time it's translated out as crown. A crown, a mark of royal or, in general, exalted rank. The wreath or garland, which was given as a prize to victors in public games. It's a metaphor for the eternal blessedness, which will be given as a prize to the genuine servants of God and Christ. I love that, the genuine, right? The genuine. Oh, I love that word at this stage of the game. Oh, yes. Those who don't take up their cross are not worthy of me, right? The genuine servants of God and Christ. The crown wreath, which is the reward of righteousness. Oh, yes. That which is an ornament and honor to one. So this is the outcome, the progression of faith. For me, that's what this is. That's what this is all about. That we're going to be in that state, in the day of fury, in the day of wrath, in the day of the Lord, where he's going to look at us and say, aha, now that's a true Israelite in whom is found no guile, right? The outcome of the progression of faith. Now we'll come down into the scriptures, because this is the Lord Jesus Christ, right? And the crown of thorns. The crown of thorns. And I just know in my spirit that this crown of thorns, something in the scriptures that I'm a long way from finding rest on what it actually pertains to, but the crown of thorns in its entirety, but I'm absolutely being led to think that it's connected to the curse in the Garden of Eden. It wasn't a curse given down to the man. It was the ground was cursed for the man's sake. Thorns and thistles shall that ground bring unto you, right? And for me, that's how they're mocking the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm being led to think that's what could be happening here, as they give him the crown of thorns, and they put it on his head. And I just go back to what we just saw about the Christmas decorations, because we're getting the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ potentially could pertain. That's the Christmas decorations, the garland. And now they're plaiting a crown of thorns, the garland, on his death. And this word, this Greek word for crown, G4735, for me, apart from them mocking the Lord Jesus Christ, it's pertaining to, that's it here for me. So this is flesh and spirit, right? This is where the two twain meet for me. The corruptible crown, so we're sowing to our carnal or our spiritual body. And that's what we get in the outline of biblical usage. The genuine servants of God and Christ, we're sowing to our eternal bodies as we search for the crown of righteousness, right? The outcome of the progression of faith. And for me, that's what we're getting here in 1 Corinthians 9:25. The corruptible crown versus the incorruptible crown. And that's where these two twain meet. Because every other scripture that I'm seeing is that we're talking about, apart from the Lord Jesus Christ wearing the crown of thorns, for me, we're talking about the crown of the joy and crown. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown. So the Philippians, for me, the most sorted, the Philippians were just sorted. They seem to be the most together of all the churches that Paul visited. And they're his joy and his crown. For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all of them that also love his appearing. Because the day of the Lord is going to be a dark day. It's the day of fury. It's the day of the wrath of the Lord. But we're going to see him, just like what we read in 1 John, we're going to see him for as he is, because we're being translated due to the progression of faith into his glorious image, right? And we're going to rejoice at his appearing as we strive for the crown of life, right? The crown of life, the garland. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him, right? So that for me is talking about, again, the progression of faith, the fry pan of faith in the hotbed of filth that is planet Babylon. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away, crown of life. No man take thy crown. And on their heads, the 24 elders, they had crowns of gold. And we're talking about the white horse, and a crown was given to him, and the shapes of the locust. So I'm being led to think that this could be pertaining to evil having its day, as is this in Revelation 9. But then we get this one I'm talking about in Revelation 12, where the other version's giving us a garland. But the King James, it's a crown of 12 stars. So a garland, right? A garland of 12 stars. So we come back into planet Babylon for Maseroth, and that's what we're getting, a garland of crowns. So we're getting a crown of 12 stars, and this for me is most certainly Israel, because this is Joseph's dream. So when we come into Blue Letter Bible, Blue Letter Bible tells us that it's their view that Revelation 12, the woman that appears in Revelation 12, is actually Israel herself, the bride. Now, I'm not settled on that, because I'm being led to think that Israel is actually the Lord Jesus Christ, the olive tree, but the occupants within Israel are the bride. That's what I'm being led to think. But Blue Letter Bible, they're saying that the actual woman is Israel. Now, I see that in Revelation 12, because this is Joseph's dream. Jacob, Rachel, and the 11 brothers, right? Joseph making up the 12th brother. So that's what I'm seeing here. This is most certainly, I see why Blue Letter Bible are being led to think this, because that's what, for me, this says as well. But I see other scriptures where, for me, Israel is actually the Lord Jesus Christ, was all the way along, but the occupants of Israel are the bride. But in any case, that's what we're absolutely getting here for me. This is a manifestation of Israel. This is a manifestation of Joseph's dream. So Maseroth, right? Strongly, fever pitch, just about settled that we're talking about Maseroth, the 12 stars actually being the 12 planets that we're getting in the Old Testament. So we come back into planet Babylon for Maseroth, and we get, according to 10th century biblical exegete, that bloke, while others interpret the word as garland of crowns. So he's saying literally meaning constellations, right? And that's what we're absolutely getting for the Hebrew word for planet. Planets are actually constellations, the 12 star signs that make up Maseroth, that which is what we're getting here. Just a fever pitch, that's what we're talking about here, and that's what we're talking about here in Revelation 12. That's for me, that's absolutely what we're talking about. This is Maseroth. I'm fever pitch, man. We're talking about Maseroth. So it doesn't finish here, but its context is that of. So we click on into the article, and we get others interpret that the word as garland of crowns, but its context is that of astronomical constellations. So for me, that's what we're talking about. For me, this Maseroth, this planet Babylon, for me, is describing this. Now, we come into the images, and for me, it's absolutely wall to wall, these 12 star signs once again. Now we put that Hebrew letter for planets in the planet Babylon, and that's what we're getting. We're getting these 12 lodging places of the sun, these 12 star signs that we see today. It's exactly the same, right? So I'm being led to think here, we're looking at the 12 lodging places of the sun. We're looking at the 12 planets combined, and they make up Maseroth. And Maseroth for me are the 12 tribes of Israel, and we get in the sense of distinction, H5144, And this pertains to the Nazarite being separate, being consecrated to God. And one time we see it in the scriptures, that's where I'm getting to here, we get Arcturus. But can thou bring forth Maseroth in his season? This for me is the host of the Lord going forth out of the land of Egypt, potentially in Exodus 12, the two Israels. Numbers 33:1, where we've got the children of Israel went forth with their armies. We're getting two distinctive Israels going on for me. Terrestrial Israel and celestial Israel. And in the Chaldee lexicon, we get the signs of the zodiac lodgings, right? The 12 lodging places of the sun, and we get this mystifying Lucifer. But we're getting, most certainly, that we're getting, again, the signs of the zodiac, the lodgings, which for me are these 12 star signs that we see them worshipping today, the 12 lodging places of the sun. This for me is the circle of palaces, Maseroth being a combination, being all 12 of the planets combined, and this makes up the circle of palaces, right? So we now come back to Areopagus. So Areopagus means martial peak, which for me pertains potentially to a mountain, a rocky height in the city of Athens. And the word martial, it pertains to war, and Mars is the god of war. I'm being led to think that Mars, he's a planet, he's the god, and his planet is actually Mars's hill. Each celestial body has their own planet. Each god is not the planet itself, like Planet Babylon's telling us today. So Mercury, the actual celestial body we see up there now, for me, that's the actual god. And Mercury's planet is actually his mountain, which I'm being led to think is Nebo. And Areopagus, Mars's hill, is the actual planet of the god of Mars. And they both make up, they're two of the 12. They're two of the 12 planets that make up the circle of palaces. Because we get this hill belonged to Ares, which is Mars, and was called Mars's hill, so called because, as the story went, Mars, having slain, no way I'm going to try and say that one. Son of Neptune, for the attempted violation of his daughter, not going to try and say that one either, was tried for the murder here before the 12 gods as judges. So for me, that's significant. Because the tools is telling us here that we're looking at 12 gods. And this is where Paul is. Paul's been brought to Areopagus and he's standing in the midst of Mars Hill. For me, it's the same place, but we're getting a different translation of the same Greek word. Areopagus for me is actually Mars's Hill. So for me, that's where I'm strongly being led to think, even more by the very moment, that Paul is actually, he's actually standing before the 12 gods, including Mars, Ares, and that's where he actually is. He's standing in the midst, in the middle, right at the top, the zenith, the peak of Mars's actual planet, his mountain, his hill. For me, that's where Paul is. And we get this place was the location where the judges convened, who by the appointment of Solon had jurisdiction of capital offences as willful murder, arson, poison, malicious wounding, and breach of the established religious usages. So this is the circle of palaces for me. But this is the thing. I'm seeing these are the 12 tribes of Israel for me, but I'm seeing here that this is the same circle of palaces, but this is made up of the strange gods that Israel were actually worshipping. So I'm getting quite vexed on this one, but we're just going to plow forward and see what truth reveals itself here, see what the Holy Spirit gives us, because that's what I'm most certainly seeing. And for me, this is significant because we've got the 12 gods as judges. So we come back now into Psalm 82, and this is now the question. Is the congregation of the mighty actually the circle of palaces?
Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words remain forever. But no one knows the date and hour when the end will be, not even the angels, no, nor even God's Son. Only the Father knows. The world will be at ease, banquets and parties and weddings, just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the fields, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks. One will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold. A piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come, you've been left behind. Goodbye.